but it's not been easy for them. Their lead singer Billy Corgan's life has been a catalogue of disaster and tragedy, and being a Smashing Pumpkin is probably one of the most difficult jobs in showbiz. So before we have a look in there, and before we talk to some fans, let's have a look at the story of the Smashing Pumpkins.
We all started, the four of us. Nobody gave two f**ks about us. Nobody, zero, nobody. I mean, we used to beg friends and family to come to the show so we wouldn't be embarrassed, okay? Nobody cared about us. We built our little egg up to the point where we were on TV and people cared and come to the concert. After the kind of the grunge explosion in the early 90s, which was about immediacy, then everybody got, all of a sudden we got very serious and things got very serious, the money got bigger and all that kind of like danger went out of it. So everything in white rock slows down and then here comes everybody else kind of blowing by us and we can't understand what's happening.
Yes, Smashing Pumpkins!
Thanks to everybody in Europe who supported us.
We're happy to be part of the oncoming American invasion, landing on your shores immediately. Thank you.
Playing live is no less or more important than making records. And we approach each one separately. I mean, the two are synonymous in the sense that it's us and we're playing the same material, but we try to interpret each one appropriately to the medium.
It's not so easy to turn around and go, you know, I want to remove this 25% of this such a successful thing that's totally changed my life. You know, I just want to toss you just out just to see what'll happen. There's a fear there that you're going to blow the little balloon up and there ain't going to be nothing left. Well, what we're trying to say to people is, we finally faced that fear. We said, we don't give a f*** if it destroys the band. Who the f*** cares? He's got to go for himself and for us. And so we're carrying on without him. If people don't like it, if he sucks, whatever, that's rock and roll tragedy. But the fact of the matter is, we faced that fear. For every person that questions this kind of decision, they didn't sit with him on a bus at 4 a.m. where he called us all sorts of names. They didn't see him not show up for practice. Completely disappeared. They didn't have a recording session with him where he just completely disappeared. You didn't even know if he was dead. And then you hear reports, oh yeah, he went to the REM. You know, they didn't live through all these things. We faced the boogeyman, and you know what? It's fine. We're totally fine, and the band sounds great, and we're going to go on tour, and you know what? It's not going to be a sad violin tour at all. It's going to be exactly the opposite. We're going to go out and have a good time.
The whole new movement within hip-hop, you know, the Wu-Tang and Missy Elliott. It's brilliant. It's great. The energy there is so great. And people may not see this, but when I watch Missy Elliott, it's the same thing as when I watched Soundgarden for the first time. I get that same excitement, and you feel like somebody's doing something that's so new. You know, maybe to some people it sounds like the same old thing, but to me it sounds so fresh. And I want to stay there. I want to be there all the time. I want that feeling all the time. It's really the first time I felt that kind of
why are you guys changing? Like for real, why are you changing? Like, this is the, you know, not the worst thing you can do, but this makes the least sense in light of everything that's happened. But that's what I try to explain to fans, is it's exactly what the band's always been about. So to not change because you're successful is totally against everything that we stand for.
Taking all the textures of all past music and trying to apply it to a kind of a new song form. And it's all just, it's very songy, you know. There's not a lot of guitar, there's one guitar solo, I mean, that lasts 4 seconds, you know. It's like, I think people are going to be surprised by the kind of reversal in a lot of ways. But the people that say it's acoustic will be wrong. The people that say it's electronic will be wrong. The people that say it sounds like a Pumpkins record will be wrong. I've tried to make something that is indescribable.
Here we are, rock and roll. We're on the steps of the Shepherd's Bush Empire. It's hours before the Smashing Pumpkins are due to take the stage. You guys are here early.
Yeah, we got here about 9:30, so... it better be worth it. It better be work out okay.
And was your journey down here a long one?
About 5.5 hours yesterday in the sun, so it was quite hot.
So from your accent, I'll have a wild stab in the dark that you've come all the way from Scotland.
Yeah, just above Edinburgh I came from, so...
one of the most notoriously difficult gigs in the world to get tickets for. How on earth did you get yours?
Well, we got them through a tout in the NME, so they were £50 each.
£50 sterling.
Yeah.
You must love this band.
Yeah, we're lucky now though, because they're going for about 100, so we've got them just in time.
Yes, you can tell by the way that I'm pertly poised with my hand on a bollard at the back passage of the Shepherd's Bush Empire that it's time for a kind of a rock and roll guided tour of the backstage to get our juices really flowing for tonight's extravaganza. So let's just have a look around. We've got a little bit of symbolics going on here. Look. An old, that's a Harley, the Harley Davidson motorcycle that represents like the old style rocking Pumpkins. There's a new, very sexy kind of technological motorbike that kind of represents the new technological Pumpkins. And look, it's called Rockwood Place. Rock, dude. Nice hubcaps, man. Very nice. You can, hang on, let me just do my London W12. They'll be gone by the time this is finished. And then we go to the next truck, which is, I'm reliably informed, what we call in showbiz, the gallery. This is the nerve center. This is like the bridge on board the USS Enterprise with the Hamish, the sexy director, and lots of other people who hopefully do know what they're doing. Don't be confused by the BBC logo up there on this nerve center truck. It's just that we actually went into the BBC car park and nicked this van early this morning at about 6 o'clock. So Antiques Roadshow this weekend ain't gonna happen. But that is where it all happens. That is where Hamish the director and all his minions and servants will be at cowing and towing to his every wish camera-wise. There's a little baby truck, which is the satellite link, which goes up to, obviously, a great big satellite so that we can all enjoy this together live, 100% live across the UK and Ireland. And then come over here. We've got a whole load of batteria. We've got a whole load of, like, skin thumping going along here. Behind me, you can see the main drum kit. Obviously, they've not found a replacement drummer, but they have an on-tour drummer. Crash, bang, wallop. Here we are, center stage, Shepherd's Bush Empire. Not long ago, this was where Terry Wogan would have been standing. Tonight, thank God, it's not Terry, it's Billy Corgan, enigmatic lead singer of the Smashing Pumpkins. X marks a spot where he will be standing in between these myriad of effects pedals for his guitar. To his right, Darcy, their cool bass player. To his left, James Ehar, their cool guitarist. You will be out there. We are deep, deep, deep backstage now in the honeycomb of passageways and corridors behind the stage where we last met. Yes, it's MTV UK. Yes, you're going to see the Pumpkins play 100% live. Yes, I'm going to interview them in a few minutes. Me, a big fan. Them, one of the most notoriously difficult to interview bands in showbiz. Very, very nervous. One thing that I've got to do before I go interview Billy and James and Darcy. Yeah.
MTV's Party Zone.
I was thinking how sad I was. I'm really like, I don't know why.
Ladies and gentlemen of the UK and Ireland and New Zealand, a day later, the Smashing Pumpkins. Oh yeah, here we go. We are so stoked to have you playing live for us on MTV UK. Gearing up for the only UK... Oh yeah, right. just get us in the right frame of mind. We're gearing up. You're poised to go on stage for the only UK airing of Adore, which is beautiful, by the way, totally beautiful. We are very, very excited. How are you feeling at this point?
Pretty crappy.
Illness. There's something in the water here, or illness has struck. Do we have to be worried?
We're happy overall.
We had a couple lumps in the road.
Yeah.
We're coming off the back of Melancholy and Infinite Sadness, which you said, Billy, that you couldn't represent live. How are you going to pull?
Because then we went out and we did it.
Exactly, you did. So I was going to say, how are you going to pull this one off? Because the album's so full of beats and technical jiggery pokery. Are you making it more difficult for yourself?
No, I think what we did was we decided to...
Did you say technical jiggery pokery?
I said technical jiggery pokery.
What does that mean exactly?
Technical schmuggins, schmear, you know, just stuff.
We kind of made a conscious decision that there was no way that we were going to be able to kind of reproduce the technical side of the album, because it would have meant probably playing the tapes and things, or have a DJ or something. So we just decided, we just got three drummers, and so what we're kind of doing is more reinterpreting the music, so.
All through drums.
So if you listen to tonight's concert and you don't like it, it doesn't mean you won't like the album, because it doesn't really sound that much like that.
The album isn't all drums.
How come only one UK day in such a tiny venue, because you are a Wembley Stadium band?
Stupidity?
Surely not. You're doing yourself down.
Well, it's a protest because we weren't picked for the World Cup.
Adore sounds like you've really discovered technology in a very big way.
I would have to disagree with you on that.
Okay, well you know, you hinted on it on Melancholy,
yeah,
but you seem to have really embraced it here.
Well, we had no choice. That's the big difference. I mean, we had no choice. We found ourselves with no drummer. And we didn't really have anything going on, so, you know, we're in the middle of making an album, we got no drummer, and there really was no choice but to start playing with beats, and it just kind of took a life of its own, and then...
So it wasn't a premeditated thing, it was something that reared its head during the recording.
No. We talked about doing, like, more of a, you know, like, I made the mistake of calling it techno, you know, and when I said techno, I didn't mean the style techno, I just meant technological.
Yeah.
But, you know... We never were into fads. I mean, we were playing hard rock before anybody liked hard rock, and suddenly we found ourselves like kind of looking, are we just following the trend? Or it's not really our style. So, in fact, our style is more to go the other way. It just worked out this way. I mean, it, you know, it doesn't sound like Garbage. I mean, the band.
Yeah.
You know, Garbage has gone very kind of like more electronic. It doesn't sound at all like that.
The sound of it is gorgeous. Layered, it's like a quiet wall of sound. A phrase that came to me when I was listening to it in the early hours of the morning was a wolf in lamb's clothing. That's how I felt it. Is that how you meant it?
Yeah.
I like that. That's a good description.
That's good. We'll go with that.
Yeah, we're going to use that from now on. Hope you don't mind. Don't sue us or anything.
Fantastic. All right, I'll invoice you on Monday.
Yeah.
Very few people have picked up on that part of the record. I think they just get drawn. Like, most people's reaction so far is, because it doesn't have these big rock anthems on it like our past albums do, they go, oh, you're much nicer and everything's much nicer. They kind of miss the darkness in the record because they just get taken away by the kind of the immediate difference.
So is this the end of that full-on Smashing Pumpkins guitar sound?
That's the other...
It's only the beginning.
The end is the beginning.
That's the end. That's the other mistake that people are making, is they're taking this as like some kind of, say, us saying... We completely reject rock and roll, and
we're putting down our guitars.
Yeah, we've gone folk. It's not like that.
It is really like we're starting over again, because it's in a way very similar to the music that we played with our little drum machine before Jimmy was in the band. It's like we've gone back and started over again, but with all these new, you know, all this new knowledge and wisdom and
jadedness,
cynicism, and
it's got a lot. Yeah. Going back to Melancholy, the whopper of a double album, your bid for rock royalty, and it all went, you pulled it off, it all went Led Zeppelin, it all went Pink Floyd for you. I mean, think back to those days in the little rehearsal space with Stumpy the three-legged cat. It all came true, didn't it?
Yeah.
God, right. I never thought about that.
Never thought about what?
I mean, I don't know whatever you're saying there.
Well, you don't
I
mean, even know what
I'm
saying.
Good. Well, what I'm saying is that, you know, way back then, in your little rehearsal space in Chicago, presumably, mm-hmm. with Stumpy the three-legged cat that I read about that made me laugh, Billy was what we call larging it, saying that the Smashing Pumpkins are going to be one of the greatest bands on the face of the earth. Cast your mind back to then. Were you thinking, Darcy and James, were you thinking, yeah, he's right? Or were thinking, Christ, call an ambulance?
That image at that moment is, he doesn't even remember that. That is just like etched in my mind, and I'm like, well, yeah.
I remember the cat.
I just thought, of course, sir, I wouldn't be putting up with any of this bullshit. You know, I wouldn't be putting myself through this hell if I didn't think that something was going to come of it.
And now
it was really hard. It was very hard, you know.
And now that you've arrived,
Stumpy, he was the best thing about it. Don't diss Stumpy. Yes.
Oh, would I ever diss Stumpy? You couldn't sort of name perhaps a song as a turning point. You say it was a tour rather than.
No, you know, we've had songs which, you know, some people consider, you know, like, you know, their prom song, you know, their Champagne Supernovas and stuff. But we didn't get the radio support, so people don't like. We've had these weird things where we've had like these huge songs with people, you know, we play them, people are crying and everybody's singing, but those didn't get played on the radio. Then we had the songs that got played on the radio, but those aren't necessarily the songs that connected with people. So we've never had that one kind of moment.
Defining
moment. We just haven't had it.
Maybe we just picked the wrong single.
I have read reams of stuff in the last 24 hours about what other people have been writing about you. And one...
Interesting,
I'm sorry.
Wow, it's intense. It's pretty intense, just like your record. One headline that I saw in the reams of stuff, which were kind of leapt at me, and I wanted to get your reaction on it. Big, great headline. It said, brilliant, worshipped, cursed.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
What's your reaction to that?
That's pretty accurate.
You say that's the Smashing Pumpkins in a nutshell.
You know, I think it kind of summed up the band. I mean, we've had the kind of success people dream about. We have, you know, one of the most devoted fan bases you could imagine. I mean, you know, we're like one of the top bands on the internet as far as sites, crazy people jumping off roofs. You know, the whole kit and caboodle of what goes with it. But there's,
don't jump off the roof.
But there's this kind of, there's always this kind of lingering energy around the band that either is negative or, you know, bad things seem to happen or whatever.
Seems to be getting better lately, though. There were about three or four years there where we just felt like a black cloud was floating over the band.
You know, classic Spinal Tap. You know, we're about to like storm America. You know, do this huge monster tour, and then, poof, you know, no drummer anymore.
Guys, whatever you've got in store for us tonight, I can't wait.
Even if it's crap.
No, really, I can't wait. I'm about to explode. Can you just tell me something about tonight's show that will just keep the wolf from the door, stop me from exploding?
Something about tonight's show.
Yeah, just without giving, you know, too much away, obviously there'll be a few surprises. Just tell me what I'm going to expect.
There's no light show. You pretty much stand there, play.
So this is a real good promo to get people to watch the show.
Percussionists dance around a lot. I don't want to build you up, you know, and get you all excited and then have you be disappointed. No, we've had great reactions to the shows that we've played, and we've really enjoyed them probably more than any other shows that we've ever played. It's been really amazing. People sitting out there listening to these songs they've never heard before, and at least acting like they're loving it. So I couldn't explain it. It's a phenomenon to me, but we're enjoying it immensely. And I hope you do too.
Billy, Darcy, James, Smashing Pumpkins, thanks a million.
Thank you.
So there you have it, the other side of this coming break. The Smashing Pumpkins will dazzle you 100% live across the UK and Ireland. Wish them luck.
Good luck.